also welcome, sir, to this meeting, and Dr. Aisha and all other dignitaries. So with this few words, I would like to invite Dr. Shaijas, who is the coordinator of today's CME program, to take over and conduct further proceedings of the CME. Also, I would like to bring into your notice that Dr. Faisi will be joining us late, who has agreed to inaugurate today's CME, and we'll have the inauguration of the official inauguration of the CME as soon as he joins for the program. Over to Dr. Shaijas. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Kunjimuddin, for this opportunity to be a coordinator for the last one amongst the series of webinars that we have been conducting. This is, as Dr. Kunjimuddin already told, an activity of the Reproductive Health Committee, Reproductive Medicine Committee of Kerala Federation. And it's a privilege that that we are here today involving the Kasaragod, Kannur, Calicut and Perinthalmanna societies on a very, very important topic, that is endometriosis. Without wasting any more time, let me get on with the first session. It's my privilege to introduce the chairpersons for this particular session. Hope my slide is visible.
Yes.
Yeah, visible only, visible.
Thank you, thank you. It's my pleasure to introduce the first chairperson of the first session, none other than Dr. M.K. Walson. He has been a mentor figure and a teacher for me. He is the medical director of Walson's Infertility Center at Kozhikode. Sir was the past HOD of Department of OBG at MES Medical College, Perinthalmanna. He's an excellent teacher with special interest in infertility as well as laparoscopy, and much more than the other academic credentials, he's also a Sanskrit expert. It's also a privilege to introduce the next chairperson, Dr. Ashwathi Kumaran, who's the consultant reproductive medicine at Aster Miracle, the fertility unit at Aster, located at Kottakkal in Malappuram district. So I welcome both the chairpersons to this particular session. And may I request Dr. Ashwathi to introduce Dr. Bhavin Balakrishnan, whose CV I would be displaying now, and to carry on with the session on medical management of endometriosis.
Thank you, Dr. Shaijas. Let me begin by thanking Perinthalmanna OBG Society and KF4G for giving me this opportunity to chair the session on endometriosis. Now, without much delay, let me introduce today's speaker, Dr. Bhavin Balakrishnan. Sir is consultant, gynecologist and fertility specialist at GFERT, IVF and Baby Memorial Hospital, Kozhikode. His special interests are in the developmental origin of health and disease, and he has won the Heartfelt Award Asia Pacific Rim Society 2004, Japan. I invite sir for his talk on medical management of endometriosis. Over to you, sir.
Good evening to entire FOXI committee. Let me just start sharing the screen. Is it visible to the entire KM? Shaijas, is it visible?
Not yet.
I don't know how this is not coming. It just came something back.
Earlier it has come, actually.
Yes, yes. Sometime again, share.
Yeah. It's coming.
Yes.
Now?
Slideshow.
Yes. Is it now visible?
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
A very good evening to the entire organizing committee. First of all, my courtesy and gratitude. Thank you, Kunjimuddin. Thank you, Shaijas. And entire KFOG Reproductive Medicine Committee in association with Kasaragod, Kannur, Calicut, Perinthalmanna, ONG Society. And thank you for this opportunity that I always share this dear topic. Firstly, gratitude always to my teachers, who has been very instrumental in shaping my practice. I declare that I don't have any conflict of interest. as my CV says, that I did my undergraduation and post-graduation from Mumbai University, practicing in Calicut at two centers right now in Kozhikode. I always was interested with the social cultural problems related to the origins of polycystic ovarian syndrome and endometriosis. First, let me cite this article, which has come lately on the February 2020 ASRM journal. They say that most important right now, ART has gone with the wind. The effects of endometriosis on ART, gone with the wind, means it is very important that what we did 25, 20 years back is now not the protocol that we have to follow. Things have changed, technology has changed. If it is a pain management, it is different. If it is pain with infertility, it is different. And ART has now become primarily most important in managing of patients with infertility and endometriotic disease. Firstly, a clinical scenario just happened a few days back. A Mrs. A, she's 31 years, B.Tech.
Hello.
But however, she could not complete her B.Tech. She has married to a farmer, suffers chronic pelvic pain and severe menstrual heavy loss in the last 4 years. She had uneventful vaginal delivery 4.5 years back. The child is doing well. She is diagnosed as diffuse adenomyosis and small ovarian endometriomas. She was on Dynogest, now shifted to Mirena. She still has this pain and she is bleeding excessively with the Mirena inside. She's also considered as iron deficiency anemia. What is the next modality of treatment is what she has come to me with a few days back. She keeps asking me why this pain and excessive flow cycles with Mirena exist. The following slides will explain more on what is the problem other than this pain. We have to start rethinking the mechanisms, diagnosis and management of endometriosis. This is an article which has come again off latest 2019, 2020, rethinking the diagnosis. Medical treatment is the first line therapeutic option for patients with pelvic pain and no desire for immediate pregnancy. But if a patient is infertile, consideration should be made regarding whether to provide ART prior to performing endometriosis surgery. And modern endometriosis management should be individualized patients in a multidisciplinary approach and also multimodal. This is most important, interdisciplinary, integrated and multimodal. So endometriosis life, if you ask these couples, in fact, the lady is relating to her life like an endometriosis, whether she's had one child or even no child. Patient-centered, multimodal, interdisciplinary approach. What we are going to treat the HPO axis with all the available drugs. This is my index, which I'm going to speak on. If we can pick up this disease as early as adolescence or even later, we can even seriously reduce the disease progressing. Pain management, medications, or psychology sessions are important. Endometriosis, some points to ponder. It's a very chronic inflammatory reaction which starts very long back. So when we see a patient, it is approximately 6-7 years which has passed with this chronic inflammatory reaction affecting the uterus, the fallopian tubes, or even the ovaries or nearby pelvic organs. Many are asymptomatic, which is a sad situation. Issues related to the late delayed diagnosis. And most of these couples, they explain effect on their social life, sexual life. Most of the time, we do not look into this aspect. Work is affected, even their studies. So they consider this as an endometriosis life. And mostly important to all the delegates, I say, assess the cognitive function, how they are perceiving and how they are judgmenting even with this disease and pain. I have recently started looking at the compartment study of when I do a transvaginal ultrasound, the anterior compartment, which looks at the bladder, the ureter, the vesico-uterine recess. You have to start looking from the perineal go upwards. Even the middle compartment is the uterus, ovary, and the fallopian tube. And we have the posterior compartment, rectocervical area, rectosigmoid, and rectovaginal septum. And I've started introducing and explaining to the patient, this is what is happening in this endometriosis. So which part we are more, so we can have either an ovarian endometriosis or a peritoneal endometriosis or a deep peritoneal endometriosis. So simply, this is the three classifications of endometriosis. Ideally, we are not supposed to use any biomarkers. Please stay away from these biomarkers, neither immunological biomarkers, including CA125. Many of the time, CA125 in plasma, urine, or serum is not a diagnosis for endometriosis. Pain. When we look at pain, medical management of infertility is pain is the most important. The pain can be at different levels. It can be during menses. It can be during motion passing, or it can be even passing urine. It can be during sex. It can be pain during the entire cycle, or it can be a chronic pelvic pain. So this pain is what we have to deal with, but it does not solve a patient to get pregnant. So HPO axis and all that we are talking about drugs is where we are going to act at different level. If we are using GnRH analogs, we are going to look at the hypothalamus. If we are looking at estrogen progesterone, we're looking at the LH and FSH with the ovaries. So that is how either we seize the endometrial growth. And this concept came in 1992, called as the estrogen threshold hypothesis. The enough estrogen that keeps a person going, but the enough estrogen that should be not allowed to endometrium or the endometriotic ectopic tissue to survive more. Judicious use of analgesics have been reported by these couples or even young girls. Most frequently is used as a Meftal spas. However, they have been using for a lifetime and it is not safe. So we have to advise them even what analgesic they have to use. It can be something different, but not always Meftal or mefenamic acid. Precise use of, I use the word precise, use of hormonal contraceptives, progestins, levonorgestrel devices, danazol, GnRH agonist. And the list continues even much more. We have amitriptyline and psychiatric medicines. What has Cochrane Library in the last two decades to talk about the oral contraceptive pain associated with review? We have so many drugs. I've just put up two photographs of Dyne with overall G and a lot of material is a filled up slide. But what we have to understand from this Cochrane is still further research is required to evaluate the role of OCPs, because the trial that which is happening is OCP versus placebo, OCP versus goserelin, that is Zoladex, or OCP versus leuprolide. So we do not have a trial purely on this. So, but still we are seeing a definite evidence, but not on a long-term basis. The same mentions by the European Journal of Contraceptive Reproductive Healthcare, which explains hormonal contraception needs even further trials. This is way just early in 2019, January 21. Danazol. Danazol is a drug I was really favorite with it, because it was a time 1992-94 where we were all using danazol, and Cochrane still says danazol for pelvic associated with endometriosis. Cindy Farkour has given it in 2007, where he mentions that it is effective in treating the symptoms, even the signs. However, this drug had to be gradually withdrawn because of its androgenic side effects, and much of our seniors and even our colleagues, friends will also realize they were all having Cushingoid features, hirsutism, hypertension, diabetes. So this drug gradually waned off. Then comes a new category of drugs called the progestins, the progesterone. We have the progesterone in the form of Implanon. Implanon is a drug which is not, I don't think it is available here. I've used a lot of Dopa-Provada for this. It is monthly, three monthly, we can take it. And off late, we have even introduced Visan, Dynofest. A lot of medicines are available in the market. We have even so-called progesterone called Duphastone, which is also available. But all this have one particular concern is no long studies for more than maximum 65 weeks, that is not more than 2 years. And even mifepristone, yes, it causes a definite reduction in pain. Pain, moderate to severe pain, mifepristone causes a definite reduction, but no long-term studies. Dynogest versus OC pills. Yes, it is still undergoing the trial. You can see it on the slide. It is 29 February 2020. It is still under the trial, but of late they have shown Dynogest is similar and non-inferior to oral contraceptive OC pills. So this is what they have to take about the product. The product which has been studied, the Dynogest, is the Visan, and they have shown statistically reduction of endometrioma. And I have started using in patients, especially adolescents, young 19, 20, with large endometriomas. And I have seen more than 60% reduction of this endometriotic size. Even the symptoms have ceased. many studies regarding VISAN, and you can see this particular study, which is showing up to 65 weeks, not beyond that. And pelvic pain is definitely going down, and menstrual bleeding is also going down. And the best part is the safety profile. But however, we have recommendations for Dynogest. You have to know which brand to select, and long-term, more than 15 months, you need to give. If the patient is doing good with 3 months, let it continue. Bone marrow density going lessening is a big major concern. Subjective improvements are very important assessing whether we need to give it on a long term. Instrumental menstrual bleeding is the most common problem when we give a Dynogest, but it is definitely efficacious in young girls. We have another choice called Mirena. Mirena is an intrauterine device which contains progesterone in the LNG method. And this is available again in the market, 2-3 more brands. It's a simple device which goes inside the uterus and releases progesterone on a very minuscule doses over the long period. And here I have used in patients, even the evidence shows more relief with adenomyosis rather endometriosis. This is another indication for using medical therapy for endometriosis. Prior to surgery, like 3 months time, we can take, and post-surgery also we can continue. Again, we have OC pills and even the progestins on a long-term basis, especially after the laparoscopic surgery. Here is another case. This shown is a device which is called Zoladex. She's a doctor, she's 32 years. She's yet to conceive. She's diagnosed endometriosis, bilateral cystectomy and adhesiolysis. She still has severe dysmenorrhea and dyspareunia. And on the scan, I found she's got ovarian endometriosis and possible deep endometriosis and even peritoneal, definitely without a doubt. So here is a case, I have a potent device called GnRH analogs, which I'm going to use this for this particular lady, and at least for 1 or 3 doses, maybe for 1 or 3, and then take her up for an ART program. Definitely it has got a beneficial effects on the pain. But here we have an issue, not bone marrow density. It is going to be related to hypoestrogenic status. Financial constraints, yes, these are costly drugs. It is costing up to 8,000 to 9,000 rupees per shot. But again, here we have to understand, we need to give higher doses of gonadotropins when we go for ART program. Clinicians are recommended, this is the ESHRAE guidelines, 2013, GnRH agonist as one of the options for reducing endometriosis pain. But again, the evidence is limited. They can prescribe hormonal add-back therapy to coincide. So I add back a therapy in the form of estrogen, progesterone, or only progesterone with a GnRH analog to give careful consideration to the use of GnRH agonist, especially in young women, because they have yet to reach their maximum bone density. Women with pain from rectovaginal endometriosis refractory to other medicals or surgical, they can consider aromatase inhibitors. This is another drug which is being studied, because this can definitely even reduce long-term management of moderate to severe pain. We can never deny to accept. We have to accept that mental health, pain symptoms and systemic comorbidities. They could be having hypothyroidism, they could be having an asthmatic disorder, or they could be having a diabetes. So please see to it all the other things are looked at, and it is a multidisciplinary integrated approach. There are very important concepts that we have to deal when we understand to treat this disease. It is a transgenerational epigenetic disease. Why? Because if a patient A is suffering this disease coming to me today, it is her grandmother, that is her father's mother, who has this disease. Fortunately, she was having a pregnancy, multiple pregnancy. She was delivering. Most of the time she was breastfeeding, lactating. This effect of endometriotic tissue outgoing, it did not happen. But this lady of today, she has changed. She is a BTech. She is qualified. She's a teacher, a doctor, much more stressed, and not really getting into marriage very early, delaying pregnancy. All this relates to some carbohydrate things to come up. Lately, there has been a study in 2019 by a group of chemists in Paris. They have studied what contains inside the endometriotic fluid, and they understood it was plasticides. So plasticides have been recovered from this endometriotic tissue. So why I'm saying, because it is associated with other disorders like asthma, diabetes, thyroid disorders, even obesity. obstetric outcomes when it is not the end of the disease where they get pregnant, miscarriages, IUGR are again common. And mind you, the patient baby also needs to be on a strict surveillance because we have to see whether they can have any other health problems. She is a patient who is nulli gravida. She's yet not had a baby. She had two conservative surgeries for endometriosis and even underwent three IVF. Finally, TLH was performed. Even now she has extrapelvic endometriosis. Now, is it some problem to do with the disease? No. Here I understand this patient is having a problem with the communication. Is it a gynecologist of today a problem? Should we blame the media as in Google? Lack of intermittent communication. So we need to understand how we can have two theories of partnership theory where we introduce the participatory role of patient and the family. It's a very effective plan in litigation prevention and more adherence to long-term plans. So the patient sticks to us for a long term. This is called the partnership theory. And we have another theory is a respect model. We connect it on them on a social level, see the patient's point of view, attempt to suspend judgment, don't avoid, recognize and avoid making assumptions. Patient has come to us for help, seek out, understand the patient's rationale, verbally acknowledge and also understand the patient's feelings. Cultural competence, this is something which is called cultural conditioning, where we are conditioned to some things in life. It is like an elephant tied to one small nail. The elephant can very well break the chain and go, but it won't. It is conditioned to understand the cultural. So we need to respect the patient, her culture and the beliefs. The patient's point of view may be different from us. Be aware from our own bias and preconception, understand our limitations in addressing medical issues and understand our personal style. So what does the patient plan? Patient has to be given a most important during the interview, write down the questions, let them come back, get feedbacks. Differential cultural counseling should be mandatory. Employ non-physicians even to assist in the counseling, and that will again give a long-term sustainability in our practice. The discussion is not complete without two important aspects. Acupuncture Cochrane recommends for pain in endometriosis, so is moderate to severe pain achieved better by the Chinese herbal medicine. So the medical management of symptomatic endometriosis is now a new weapon in the arsenal. This is again February 2020, Fertility Sterility Journal. There were a lot of advances from fertility sterility, but here is one, a new weapon, and that is oral antagonist. We have GnRH antagonist, which is oral. Two trials, which has come 2020, which is what I'm showing on the top, is out in the market, but still a lot of trials are pending. And we have also called the linzagolix and the other one is the elagolix. So these are the two drugs which could come out in the next 5 years, which is going to cause a definite reduction even in severe pelvic pain. A very interesting study by Julie Brown and Cynthia Farquhar about all the Cochrane reviews they have understood and they are published. Let's read this out. Suppression of menstrual cycle with GnRH analogs, LUG and Danazol were very beneficial. And excision of endometrioma is also associated. So I very well understand when which patient I cannot do this laparoscopy. I will immediately call up PG Paul sir and I will transfer the case in. So these are the limitations we should know. And there is no benefit or benefit with sometimes post-surgical medical treatment. And women with endometriosis undergoing ART, 3 months treatment with GnRH analogs have actually improved the pregnancy rate. Excisional surgery also improved spontaneous pregnancy rates in 9 to 12 months. Laparoscopy surgery improved live birth rate and pregnancy rate compared to simple diagnostic laparoscopy. So evidence is still limited, but GnRH analogs and Danazol depoprogestins were still going on. A not so great philosopher once said, the known knowns are the great things that we know. But we know there are some things we do not know. And the one things we do not know, we don't know. It is the latter category which is the most difficult. Thank you very much, seniors, teachers, friends, and thank you to the entire organizing committee for this session. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Bhavin. That was a very informative.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Bhavin. Chairpersons.
Am I audible?
Yes, well said, sir.
Yeah. Dr. Bhavin, you discussed all aspects of medical management of endometriosis, starting from the conventional non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs to GnRH analog. Do you have any experience with the cabergoline in as a medical management of endometriosis?
Yes, I missed that drug out, I understand. But I have used it, but I got more problems with nausea and vomiting, so I had to discontinue.
That's it. I also found that if you are using in other than the hyperprolactinemia, cabergoline can produce nausea and vomiting. But if the patient is having hyperprolactinemia, there is no symptom like that.
Okay. Okay, sir.
Then what about the complication of GnRH analog?
GnRH analog, the main major problem here when we deal with young adolescents or young women is the bone marrow density problem.
Yeah.
Secondly, is hyperestrogenic effect. So
that
we need to always give an add-back therapy. And I do not, I always give an add-back when I give a GnRH analog. However, the GnRH analog usage is again limited to ART cases. So we right. give it prior to ART and endometriosis, one or two doses, sometimes one dose is enough.
That's it. We have to individualize the cases before starting second drugs. Is there any absolute cure for endometriosis?
Absolute cure? No. But I have seen an observation. I think many of us would have seen it. Yeah. When we do a cesarean on these ladies, most of the lesions have actually regressed or disappeared. But they come back with endometrioma after 3 or 4 years. So pregnancy has got a lot of cytokines released, which could be beneficial. So still many things are to be in research.
Yes, in pregnancy, some endometrioma will lyse by itself.
Yes.
During cesarean section, we can see some dirty material covering the uterus yes. and ovaries. That is maybe due to some protective effect of pregnancy. Maybe progesterone, we don't know.
Yes. We're
talking about judicious use of analgesics and that Meftal is being overused. What would you suggest if somebody is not finding relief with Meftal spas or is overusing it?
I will suggest to them, first of all, my practice is I give a holistic care approach. I get into the social aspects, the work-life imbalance. A lot of things actually get solved with it, psychological and stress coping skills. And I tell them you can use a paracetamol or I give a very low dose amitriptyline called Amixid H, which really makes a big difference because stress here is one big problem. And the stress is because of the place that we live in, the house that we live in, the social stressors, a lot of things are there.
Amitriptyline means?
GABA medications also make some differences. So that is why the Cochrane would have mentioned acupressure and even Chinese medicine making a big effect in moderate to severe pelvic pain. And people do have even mentioned from, I've met some patients who come from Talisheri Kannur, they use this vacuum cup method in reducing the moderate to severe pelvic pain. They have vacuum cup on their body, which is given.
Yes, so it is all about mind-body therapy and then how the neurological pain can be managed. What is your opinion on melatonin use for endometriosis?
Melatonin here has only one effect because the endometrium, in the endometriotic disease, we have a problem of ovarian aging, which is going very fast. Finally, they will have an empty ovarian pool. So melatonin has been a drug which has been discovered way back 20 years ago by the Japanese at a dose of 3 mg, which is going to give a good effect on the oocyte quality. So in IVF, we have major challenges getting a good quality oocyte or even an embryo.
Is there any question from the audience?
Yeah, Bhavin, see, what is the ideal medical treatment if an adolescent girl at around presented with just one or two centimeter endometrioma on each side, but with severe pelvic pain, maybe she's a student and all. So what should be the ideal medical treatment and how long we should continue that medical treatment? What is your opinion?
I use this, in this case, I will use the partnership theory of medical practice, where I involve the family, the parents, and I give them the options of one, the role of dynogest, the role of OC pills, and the laparoscopic surgery, if there is no effect in 3 months. Let us not prolong the medications too long.
And will
That's
you
be essential.
Metoprogesterone DMPA injection for these patients?
No, I wouldn't advise.
Why can't we advise it?
Again, here is the problem, because these adolescents have yet not reached the maximum bone density. So they can result in remote endometrial osteoporosis. So we should not allow them to use it.
And one more thing, when we use a dynogest, there will be many incidents of breakthrough bleedings in between.
Yes, yes.
So how should we handle it?
First, we have to tell them that things are getting, the cyst is going down. See, it is going better. And this is how we have to, this is a counseling which I've learned from you only. And so we'll have to accept and go ahead. But tell them this is a side effect of the drug.
Yeah,
we can change the brand. We can change into an OC pill also.
Yeah, we can very well supplement with the progesterones as well, I believe.
Yes. Definitely. But again, nutraceuticals are also important in the form of multivitamins, calcium, vitamin D3. These are also important. Because
what do you think about probiotics? Probiotics, because often PID coexists with all these inflammatory pathologies. And it is now considered that the altered microbiome is responsible for the origin of endometriosis itself.
Absolutely. This is, which is very well documented 2 years back. They have studied a vaginal microbiome, and they have found out that most of the diseases the lady undergoes is because of the vaginal microflora causing endometriotic diseases, even polycystic ovarian diseases. And the next is the oral cavity. So we are finding much differences once the mask has come now. So these are the 2 areas which are considered. And in fact, the rheumatologist use, they don't even allow us to use Zentel or Albendazole. They say don't interfere with the gut flora. So gut flora and the vaginal flora is also, so here why we don't recommend douche is one of the reasons. Probiotics, yes, I do recommend. I'm using Entrogermina, but not really for pain management, no.
Yeah, shall we conclude the session, and Dr. Facius joined, we'll have the inauguration as well.
Yes, thank you so much to both the chairpersons, Wilson sir, as well as Dr. Ashwati, for wonderfully chairing this session. And to the speaker, the big man with an even bigger heart, Dr. Bhavin Balakrishnan, for wonderfully deliberating on medical management of endometriosis, which is a very, very important topic whenever we discuss the topic called endometriosis. Over to Dr. Kunjumoydeen for carrying out the inauguration session.
Thank you.